Shalom and welcome to day 3 in Kingdom Toast as we are sharing on reposition for destiny. I'm Othniel Mobili, senior pastor of the City Revival Temple in Nairobi. We meet right next to the Railway Museum behind Technical University. And I believe that God is going to bless us today as we share from the Word of God. Now, we're going to continue today sharing from the scripture, and we've been laying foundations for the past 2 days, and we began by looking at the parallel passages in chapter 6 of Judges, and we saw God calling Gideon a mighty man of valor. And we understood that one of the things that distinguished him was that he took a posture, he took a position, and he was threshing wheat at a wine press. And we began to explore the realities of threshing and the principles of the threshing floor. We want to move further because we want to understand the mind of God for us in this particular time and season. And so we also began to understand that the threshing floor is connected to the position of prayer. And we looked at Jesus Christ, and more so the introduction that Jesus Christ was given by John the Baptist as one who is on the threshing floor. The threshing floor always speaks about a harvest. It speaks about transformation. The harvest place also is a place where there is a shift or changes, because the harvest, or rather the threshing floor, is a place of separation, where you separate the wheat and the tares, where you grind the wheat, as it were, so that you can separate it and you can be able to have that which is meaningful and which is beneficial and throw away the waste. And so that is the picture of a threshing floor. But we also understood that the threshing floor is an elevated place. You can see a threshing floor from different places and different angles. And so in the spiritual plane then, a threshing floor elevates you, takes you into a place of authority. And every time you get to a place of a threshing floor, things begin to shift because God begins to do things in your life. And the things that have been deposited in your life begin to manifest. Matter of fact, at the place of the threshing floor, that is where God begins to call you who you are supposed to be, a mighty man or a mighty woman of valor. It begins to emerge, it begins to be seen. But we also began to see from the scripture, and more so the text here being Luke chapter 11, Jesus teaching his disciples how to pray. And we understood from verse 1 that when he was praying in a certain place, that is in Luke chapter 11 from verse 1, that his disciples came to him and said, "Lord, teach us how to pray, as John the Baptist also taught his disciples to pray." So they understood that because Jesus was influential, Jesus was impacting lives, Jesus was doing great things, they wanted to be like him, and they knew that the secret behind his power, the secret behind his knowing the mind and the will of God, was coming from his place of prayer, the secret place and the relationship he was cultivating between him and God. And so Jesus then takes them into a discourse, and from verse 2, he begins to teach them prayer, talking about "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in heaven as and so be it even in the earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Now, he was praying this prayer and teaching them this is a pattern. Now, this is not something that is supposed to be repeated over and over and over again. It is a pattern. It is a template. It is, so to speak, the order in which we're supposed to pray in understanding this. But we're not going into the pattern of prayer for now, but I want us to understand the story that Jesus goes on ahead to tell his disciples about a man who went at the midnight to knock at their friend's house. And we understood that this friend understood something very important and very key, is that he knew that there was bread and he refused to give up until he got the bread. Now, at the close of that story, because Jesus says, "I say unto you, though he will not rise and give him because he is his friend, yet because of his importunity, he will rise and give him as many as he needed." But verse 9 is an interesting passage, because Jesus then says, "And I say unto you, ask and it shall be given, seek and you shall find. Knock, and the door shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth. He that seeketh, findeth. And he that knocketh, shall the door be opened unto you. I pray today that you will take this posture of knocking, of seeking, and of knocking on the door, because every time you ask, you seek and knock, the Bible is saying the door will be open, you will find, and you will begin to get to know what God has for your life, because He will give unto you as much as you desire and you ask of Him. So you need to understand that in this particular season that we are living in, the purposes of God are going to be established over your life. Whatsoever thing God has said, He is not only going to do it, but He is going to surprise you, because He is able to do exceedingly and abundantly, and actually super abundantly more than you could ever think or ask or even imagine. That is the God that we serve. He is so faithful, He is so just, He is so true, and He is more than able to answer the prayers of those who seek Him. Now, listen to this, because this is what Christ goes on to say. He says, if a son asks for bread of any of you that is a father, can he give him a stone? In other words, this man comes with a posture of asking. And Christ is saying, if the son asks a father to give him bread, he in no wise is going to give him a stone. And then Jesus says, and if he asks for fish, will he give him a serpent? In other words, will the father give him something that will harm him, or something that will destroy his life? And the answer is no. We earthly fathers, we know how to give good gifts to our children. And so then Christ is simply saying, if we as earthly fathers know how to give good things to our children who take the position to ask, how much more shall our Heavenly Father? Because then we are able to tap in from the power, from the grace, from the goodness, from everything that our Father wants to give unto us when we take this position that will reposition us or move us into what God has for us. And then he says in verse 12, or if he ask for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? And verse 13, the Bible concludes to say, if then you, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask? Now, this is very interesting, because the Bible is talking about asking for fish, asking for bread, asking for an egg. But then the Bible says, if you who know how to give good things to your children, though you're evil, if you ask, how much more shall the Father give the Holy Spirit? In other words, when you come into position in God and you take your position at the threshing floor, your posture will give God the opportunity, so to speak, or it will give God the measure of love to pour upon you the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will unlock avenues of grace and doorways of favor for you at such a time as this. Now, this is very interesting passage of scripture, because if you look at this, you will begin to see the patterns of prayer emerging. They will emerge very clearly, especially if you look at another additional text that we will consider as we continue in this series, which is Luke chapter 18, in which Jesus was speaking to his disciples. And the verse 1 of chapter 18 of Luke, chapter 18 verse 1 says, and Jesus spoke to them a parable that men ought to always pray and not to faint. And then God, through Christ, of course, speaking to us today, goes on to talk about this widow woman who kept on going to a judge who did not fear man or did not fear God, and kept on asking for her right. And every time this judge did not give this woman her right, but ultimately she received, because she was persistent, she was consistent, and she was insistent. In other words, she kept at the right posture. Now, we need to understand that when you come to God, you must believe that God is faithful and God is true. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6 that whosoever shall come to God must believe that God is. So without faith, without taking a position of faith, it is impossible to please God. You must believe He is, and that He, God, is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Not just seek Him, but diligently. In other words, you are going to do it with all your heart, with all your might, with all your strength. You're going to seek Him. You're going to seek Him early. You're going to believe Him. You're going to refuse to give up. You're going to refuse to throw in the towel. You're not going to slow down. You're not going to loosen your grip. You're going to say, I have begun walking in this journey and I will not stop until God blesses me. And I believe that God wants to bless you. God wants to surprise you. God wants to open up His hand that He can satisfy your life with good things. And this morning, He is more than able to do it. But as we understand this passage, I want us to understand a very key component of prayer. That every time you come to God and you take this position, you need to see God in three dimensions, which is very important for you to understand your position as you relate to God. Now, as Jesus is teaching His disciples prayer, one of the things that emerges very well, very clearly, is He tells them, pray to God as the Father. And as when you come, you pray, our Father who art in heaven. So you need to understand that there is a relationship. Whatever you receive from God, you will receive it on the basis of relationship with Him. Matter of fact, it is a law. It is a principle in the earth realm. Everything flows along relational lines. You cannot claim to get things if you do not build relationship, even with people. It is obvious the reason why there are people or children out in the streets who may not be having enough to eat is not because they are not millionaire fathers somewhere, but those millionaire fathers who have more than enough are not related to those who are out in the streets. And so there is no channel that joins this money that is in the bank account of a billionaire to that street child who is hungering and thirsting. That relationship is what is going to pull the money. There is no way this billionaire would have billions and they have their own child and their child starves or misses any good thing. It is relationship that releases the resources. And so today I pray that we will understand our position with our Heavenly Father. And so even when Jesus is speaking, He says, when you ask your Father, He is going to give you. He's going to give you bread. He's going to give you fish. He's going to give you an egg. He won't give you something that will damage. So there's a relationship issue that has to do with prayer. So it's a posture that you need to take. And the best thing we can do, especially in this season and in our lives, is to establish a relationship with God. And the way we do it is through accepting the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord in our lives. The Bible says in John chapter 1 verse 12 that when He came to His own, from verse 11, they rejected Him. But as many, verse 12, as many, John chapter 1, as many as have received Him, they have received the power to become the sons of God. For they are not born of flesh, they are not born of water, they are not born just in the normal way, but they are born of God. And so when you receive the Lord Jesus Christ, when you believe in your heart and you confess Him in your mouth as Lord and as God, that as God has lifted Him up, then it gives you the blessed opportunity to become a son of God or a child of God. And when you become a child of God, then it gives you access, rights to everything that God has. That relationship opens up doors. That posture gives you power to be who God has called you to be. One in authority, one in great power, and one who's able to shape their world. Now, the next thing that Jesus gives us here also is a story in which He gives us a picture of a friend. Now, these are dynamics of position. But the dynamic of a friend is different from a father. Because when a father is being asked by the child, the Bible says they will give them. It is more a direct thing. But when it comes to a friend, we realize then with friendship, there is an aspect of timing that can delay the answer. There's the issues of inconveniences that may arise. There are issues of barriers, because there are doors that need to be knocked and that need to be opened. There are seasons in which those doors seem to close, and there are other seasons that they may be open. And if you knock at a night season, then you may not easily receive it. But Jesus is saying it's a principle of prayer, and even in that particular time, you need to understand that if you knock and keep on knocking, the door will be open. If you seek and you keep on seeking, the door you're going to find. If you ask and keep on asking, you will receive. So the principle here is very interesting, because that's the Greek. The Greek terminology is a continuous tense. It's not just you ask now and you stop, but you ask and keep on asking. That's how it is in the Bible. You seek and keep on seeking. You knock and keep on. That's the posture of prayer. It is continuous. You don't stop. You keep on until you get it. You keep on until you receive. You keep on until you find. That is a principle that we need to understand this morning. So when you come in the posture before God, you need to understand that this is how God works. But the last thing that I want us to understand is that God is also painted in Luke chapter 18 as a judge. So God is, number one, a father. And there are principles that govern the relationship between father and son, and how the son receives from the father. But then there are also principles whereby we need to understand God is a friend, where we can come to him and ask him, and he will give unto us based on our relationship with him as a friend. And there are principles that go with that, and activates the principle of some persistence that is needed at particular times and particular seasons. But this is also the principle of a judge. And when there is a judge, it means that there is also an adversary and an enemy, and there are petitions and there are court cases that have been presented. And so there is a relationship also that needs to be taken beyond. And so the reason why we don't receive from God is because we don't understand our posture when we come to the threshing floor, or when we come to the presence of God, where we can activate particular things to receive from him. Now we're going to continue from here, but we need to understand that God wants to give us, but there are principles that are in the Word of God. You can never change principles. You cannot even bend principles. In fact, if you try to bend a principle, you will discover you are the bent one. But I pray today that we will allow the Word of God to speak to us, and that we will rise up in faith and take our posture, take our place. And as we take our posture in power and in prayer, we will receive what God said we will receive. God bless you. I know God's going to favor you this morning. I want to pray with you and speak words of faith to you in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, we thank you yet again as we come to the closure of this day three, that we are looking at being repositioned for our destiny, where God, we can be in the position of at the threshing floor, where we can tap into the fullness of the blessing that you have released for us. Today, Lord, we look to you. We trust in you. We hope only in your truth and in your word. You have said that you will never disappoint those who trust in you, that the expectation of the righteous will never be cut off. So as we call upon you today, let your name be glorified. Let your name be honored. We worship you. We adore you. We celebrate you, and we magnify your name. Be Lord, be God, be glorified, be exalted. We love you with all of our hearts, and we know that, God, you will do it for your own name's sake. So touch your people as they go to their offices, as they go to their workplace, as they go to school, as they seek your face. Anyone who is giving up, let them receive strength in the inner man, that they may be repositioned to keep on waiting, keep on seeking, keep on knocking, keep on asking, because you are faithful. You will never fail. We bless you, Lord, and we honor you. Have your way in our lives. We pray, we give thanks in Jesus' name. I declare today you are blessed for life, and God's favor go ahead of you. God keep you, increase you, and may you take your rightful position in God by faith, because God is more than able to do even more than you could think or ask or imagine. Shalom, God's favor to you. Amen.